Today we'll be speaking with Dr. Phil Plait, who's an astronomer, science communicator, author of several books on space and our place in it, the writer and host of Crash Course Astronomy, a video series with over 70 million views on YouTube. And we are going to talk about astrology. You know, Phil, I've had so many people want me to interview someone about this. And I don't know what it is about astrology that, you know, there's lots of pseudoscience and healing sort of stuff that could be covered in detail. But something about astrology seems of particular interest to my audience. Let's kind of start at the beginning. What is astrology, and did it at one point split off from astronomy?
Trying to define astrology is actually a little bit tough, because it's like saying, how do you define, you know, medicine? There's a lot of different things, right? And astrology has its roots going back thousands and thousands of years to a bunch of different cultures. But the bottom line, I'll be really sort of generalizing here, is to say that the stars and the planets, the positions of the sun and the moon and all of that affect our lives in some way. And the most popular kind these days is sun sign astrology, where you have these 12 zodiac constellations, and depending where they are in the sky and what planets are in them, this affects your life. And it all is kind of rooted in the time of year you were born. And the bottom line, the bottom line is that it's all nonsense, is that none of it works. It doesn't make any sense. There's no guiding principle to any of this. If you talk to five astrologers, you'll get 10 different opinions. And so that's where I'm coming from. If you're a deep believer in astrology, you're probably not going to be happy about what I'm going to be talking about here.
So it seems like there is both the idea that the positions of stars, planets, and celestial bodies when we were born impacts our predispositions and personalities, etc., and also that the day-to-day positioning based on the month of the year we were born also can affect, in the by virtue of like the horoscope, can affect our immediate future. So there's sort of like a backwards looking determinative thing about personality based on what it was like when we were born, and then also the day-to-day going forward.
Pretty much, yeah. And most astrological styles, whether it's Eastern or Western or whatever culture you're gleaning this from,
yeah,
that's pretty much the basis of all of it. Yeah,
there are a number of different contradictory arguments made that claim to explain why astrology can't possibly work in the way that it's described. This includes lack of accuracy about our understanding of the positions at different points in time. It includes physical realities about some of these bodies are so far that there would be essentially a close to zero measurable impact, whether it's gravitational or whatever. So in that sense, on a physical level, it can't possibly work. Talk a little bit about what you see as the biggest scientific impossibilities of astrology.
Well, I think you pretty much nailed it there. The biggest problem with it is that there's just no underlying force, cause, physical reason for this to make sense. Why would, for example, in the most popular kind of astrology, at least in the United States, the sun sign astrology, why would it make any sense that everybody born in, you know, April or late April, or just even a given day, April 15th?
Yeah.
Why would they have any sort of guiding overlying physical effect that would run their lives, or at least, you know, astrologers like to say, you know, the stars impel, they don't compel, or something like that. You know, these are just sort of vague forces out there that can kind of guide you a little bit, but they're not forcing you into a thing. And fine, whatever. But still, what is it that somebody born on a certain date, when the planets and the moon and the sun and the earth were all in a certain configuration, why would that have any effect on your life? Now, we know about a lot of forces that are out there, and the biggest ones in the solar system would be gravity, right? An object has mass, and it pulls you toward it. So the Earth is overwhelmingly the largest gravitational force in our day-to-day lives. But the sun and the moon also have a small, much smaller effect, but it's there. That affects the tides, for example. And the planets also have an effect as well. It's really, really small. The largest gravitational effect besides the sun and the moon would be Jupiter. And it dominates all the other planets. And if you're talking about tides, which is related to gravity, but in a more complicated way, Venus completely overwhelms the other planets. And so when they talk about, you know, Neptune is in Aquarius, and that means this and this, and it's like Neptune has zero effect compared to the moon. The moon is like standing in the middle of a rock concert, and they're talking about a mosquito flapping its wings 100 yards away. It doesn't make sense that mosquito would have any effect on you compared to the raucous noise all around you. And so this is the basic problem I have with astrology. And also that if you talk to different astrologers, they have different ways of talking about all this stuff, and they don't agree. They don't agree on specific horoscopes that they cast. They say, this is what's going to happen in your life. They make very vague generalities, which I'd like to talk to about it in a second as well. But they don't agree. And you know, when you talk to scientists, we may disagree about certain very specific things, but no medical researcher is going to deny germ theory. No astronomer denies gravity. You know, we may argue about the effects of gravity and how it works when, you know, you have a trillion stars all orbiting each other, but the basic effects of it, we understand fairly well. And with astrology, despite, you know, thousands of years of working on this, there's still no real convergence on what it all means.
It also seems that when astrologers are sometimes presented with questions like, why does your framework not consider the electromagnetic influence of the sun or asteroids, for example, or whatever, they tend to go back to an equivalent of God works in mysterious ways, sort of the idea of there's some intangible here that is beyond explaining it to you, whether they know it or not. They're either keeping it to themselves or they don't know it themselves either. It seems that there's a pseudo religious element to that, where there's some unknown force where we don't have to explain why we're ignoring a whole bunch of things. And also we don't have to explain what kind of holds this whole thing together.
Oh, no, that's absolutely right. This is precisely what a lot of astrologers say. You know, you're trying to ascribe a scientific overview to this, some underlying cause, and we're saying that
it's,
you know,
beyond that.
There's something out there that we don't know about, that we don't understand. And to me, that's an admission from astrologers that they have no idea what they're talking about. because if there were this force out there, then they would all at least agree on how this stuff works. And the different kinds of astrology do not. And so, again, it doesn't make any sense. And if there's some force out there that they don't understand, but they can predict how it works and say, well, you know, we know that Neptune does this and this and this, whether, you know, how it does that, we don't know. Then my question is, why don't they ever predict the existence of these objects? No astrologer predicted the existence of Pluto, which was discovered in 1930. And Neptune's actually a good example. Neptune was found by math. Its gravity was pulling on the planet Uranus, and Uranus was never quite in the right spot. Astronomers were predicting, saying it should be, you know, precisely right here at this date, and it never was. And they said, well, something's wrong. We're missing something. And it turns out, yeah, we're missing Neptune. And the mass of Neptune is pulling on Uranus and moving it around a little tiny bit. And so the existence of that planet was predicted correctly by astronomy. So, you know, where are these predictions? And I see astrologers sometimes taking into account asteroids. And this cracks me up because asteroids weren't discovered until the 1800s. And there are literally millions and millions of them in the solar system. So if there's some force that doesn't seem to depend on distance and doesn't seem to depend on the size of the object, the asteroids should completely overwhelm everything else, and yet they don't. And I've also seen astrologers ascribe feminine qualities to asteroids, which I find fascinating, because a lot of the asteroids are named after female gods. This is just how they got named, Ceres and Vesta, the two largest ones, and a lot of the other ones. And it became tradition for astronomers to name them after female deities. And so that's just a coincidence. That's not anything real. So to ascribe feminine attributes to asteroids, whatever even feminine attributes means, is ridiculous. And so, again, this all shows me that astrologers are just making this up as they go along, and there's no underlying force behind any of this.
You talked about wanting to go back to vagueness. I think many of us have read about experiments where the same horoscope is given to everybody, regardless of birth date, and everybody says, yeah, it sort of does describe me or whatever the case may be. Talk a little bit about that. Let's go back to what you wanted to say on vagueness.
Right. And this is a big deal. Now, if you talk about newspaper horoscopes, even astrologers, professional astronomers, tend to poo-poo those because they say, oh, that's just written by somebody they've hired to make stuff up.
Yeah.
So you know, even they will say no. So we can safely ignore that. But if you go and talk about a specifically cast horoscope for a person, they tend to be vague. You know, water will play a part in your life today. Well, of course, water always, you know, I'm thirsty. Look, water's playing a part in my life.
Beautifully done.
But it's you know, money will play an important role in the next month. Well, of course it will. We live in a capitalist society. Money plays a part of my life every minute of every day. So you can say these vague generalities. And even if you get specific, a lot of the times people will remember when a prediction is correct and forget when that prediction is incorrect. So that's called hits and misses, remembering the hits and forgetting the misses. Very well-known bias in human thinking. And so if I say, you know, water will play a role, money will play a role, you'll be hit by lightning, cars will take a dominant role, and you'll read that and go, wow, lightning, gosh. And then a month passes and you're not hit by lightning, you're going to forget that prediction and say, oh my gosh, that car, yeah, I bought a new car, or I was almost hit by a car. Well, you know, when you say a car will play a role in your life, well, what does that mean? Are you going to use a car? Are you going to buy a car? Are you going to see an accident? When you start thinking about cars in general in this way, pardon me, there's a huge amount of things that it can do to be a part of your life. So that vague generality means they're going to get a hit by saying something that vague. And if they do say something specific and it doesn't happen, you forget. And you can talk to any stage magician, any stage mentalist, the kind of person who like tries to read people's minds in the audience and that sort of thing, they will sometimes throw out a very specific thing just to see if somebody gets a hit. And if they don't, the audience forgets. By the time they leave, they'll say, yeah, nobody will say, oh, do you remember when he said somebody in the audience was hit by lightning and nobody was? That was weird. They forget about that completely.
And it's often also very slickly couched as, I'm seeing either getting hit by lightning or something related to a storm. Could be water, could be wind. So now it's like, or electricity. Now it's anything, you know. Hey, last thing I want to ask you about in the limited time we have. When I've spoken to experts on cults, experts on conspiracy theories, etc., we will often start with something relatively benign, like, oh, I believe in flat earth. Then I'll ask the question, is this isolated and relatively benign? Or are people who believe in that also likely to believe anti-Semitic conspiracy theories or whatever? Are these things siloed or not? And usually it's sometimes it's siloed, but often it is not. The QAnon people and the, you know, anti-Semitic people and the COVID people, it's all there's overlap there. What about when it comes to astrology? Is it sometimes just an isolated hobby, or is it more likely that those who believe in astrology believe some of these other things?
Well, I'm not a psychologist, and I haven't studied astrology specifically in the way you're saying. So I can't say, you know, somebody who's reads their horoscope in the newspaper is also likely to be, you know, a COVID denier or you know, an anti-vaxxer or an anti-Semite.
Sure.
That seems to be a fairly big leap, and I would never say something like that. What I would say, and it's funny you would bring this up because I literally just wrote about this. It's going to be published in Scientific American very soon, that a lot of these types of beliefs have things in common that can make it easier for you to believe in worse things. And that is a denial of evidence, a belief in a conclusion without evidence, such that when evidence comes along that contradicts what you believe, you'll tend to push it aside and say, well, that's silly.
Right.
You know, this works for me, or you know, that this is the experts are lying to you, the government is lying to you, whatever. That sort of denial of expertise, denial of evidence, all of these conspiracy theories, whether it's flat Earth or Apollo moon landing deniers, which are still out there, QAnon, fossil fuel companies downplaying climate science, anti-vaxxers, QAnon, on and on and on and on. They yeah. all have these same sort of things going on underneath the surface. So, you know, the belief in astrology, relatively harmless, but it does sort of put into this idea of anti-science, anti-expertise that a lot of these other things use. And so if you believe in, say, anti-vax rhetoric, it might be easier for you to buy into other conspiracy theories. And that is a path you do not want to walk down. And that is one of the reasons why I treat belief in astrology seriously. I treat belief in, right. in people who deny the moon landing seriously. These are, I hate to use the word gateway because that has bad implications, but these can lead to worse and worse kinds of thinking, and that way chaos lies.
That is absolutely the case. So we've been speaking with astronomer Dr. Phil Plait. Really appreciate your time. We'll link out to your video series, and so great to talk to you. Keep up the great work.
Thank you very much for having me on.